Greetings, humans, living and dying in the Anthropocene. This is Jamming Their Transmission, where rebels, freaks, critics, dissidents, iconoclasts, and oddballs live. I'm your fellow traveler, John Madden. In her interview with Tobias Carroll at Volume 1 Brooklyn, Quintan Ana Wikswo says, quote, "I write like a haunting, a spirit that cannot be dislodged, that inhabits a site across time and space. Each of our beloved books are those into which we disappear in some way, are consumed, subsumed, absorbed, integrated so completely that we come as readers to inhabit the book. As an author, the only time I write is when I am comprehensively subsumed by a place, a site, and what has happened there. I disappear into a place and its time spaces the way I disappear into a night full of stars." Unquote. Quintan Ana Wikswo's semi-autobiographical projects dwell within complex histories at the intersection of gender, disability, queerness, and race, with a special focus on human rights aftermath issues. Her artwork is deeply grounded in collaborative and coalition-based organizing principles, long-term project commitments, and intersectionality. Her books include The Hope of Floating Has Carried Us This Far and A Long Curving Scar Where the Heart Should Be. She lives in rural northern New Mexico. Here is Quintan Ana Wikswo introducing and reading one of the stories from The Hope of Floating Has Carried Us This Far, published by Coffee House Press in 2015.
This is a text called Hold Fast, Crowbiter, and I wrote it in Lithuania at the site where my family, amongst many others, were murdered, and it's a area that's very much in contention and very much in danger right now of losing its independence to Russian occupation. But as I was in the woods realizing what had happened there, I found holes that the Nazis had dug to hide the tanks so that they could march people down the road and gun them down, and they're still there. I walked out into the sea. I was crying, and someone came out and explained to me this old tradition where, during wartime in Lithuania, where young women were taught to catch crows in the sea with their hands and bite their necks, and it was a special skill, and you were called a crow biter. So there would be a girl in the village that was a crow biter, and then that crow would feed the village during times of famine. So this is about the crow biter girl. Like the others, her legs are hair and stalk. This is another way of staying unmarried besides war. She is poor, and she is not fat. When she crosses the dunes, she leaves holes instead of footprints. Standing hip deep in the Baltic, her thin limbs don't disturb the waves. But she is young, and her teeth are strong, and the crows die in her mouth with a flap of black feather. Our world, a punctured lung that contracts and expands without ease. What is close comes near, then billows far away from reach. So much is evacuated, then all is spasm and gashes and wet tissue. Where there is pain, there is a gasp. Our rib cage, a cleaved accordion, the organ, no longer used for lovemaking. The air we expel is stale with fear. Please don't pick up all those rocks. Pray to be turned into a blanket, a hat, a pair of socks, anything that comforts. Pray for what now gives way that it someday hold. Pray that the dunes will stay around the roots. Prayers for bones that bend instead of break. Our prayers for our bodies to be soaked in vinegar, pickled, unable to expire. Pray for good wind, pray for calm seas, for our immortality. As often as possible, pray for something that does not exist. Give promises that predict a new kind of orifice, something that opens and closes in a part of the body that is currently undiscovered, through which something good emerges, a body mollusk, as though there are pearls waiting inside us, as though our poverty of spirit is only passing. Please don't take away all those rocks. Like the man who sailed off the edges of the sea and fell into the void, there are areas within us that contain a precipice. Start collecting sticks and cloth. Learn how to wrap them for a shroud or sailcloth. We are using them for ballast, for the time when the undiscovered has at last come into view. Consider these Caronian woods a pincushion, if possible, a soil pricked with pines that climb straight up, everything poised to hold together, the sands only half-bound upon the earth, impermanently affixed. When the winter comes, we stitch ourselves to the dunes with pine needles. The trees have nearly no branches, and yet still the wind whistles through their wooden teeth, a seducer's song, meant for the winter sun. What an armistice romance. How can the sun come down when everything here is sharp enough to kill? The Baltic sun is distant, but wisely, because it is wary of what comes with the descent. She has gone fishing again, and in this tide she struggles, thin legs wrapped up in that thick, wet pelt of bladder wrack, whole belts of it broken loose, the sloughed-off, spongy muck of the uterus at new moon, the vesicle cysts close by for buoyancy, for surfacing. What a tangle, what a mess of trumpets and vines, and the kind of crying that accompanies a split of sinew and tissue. Saline, death, birth, what of it? The insides have come out. The disgust is in transition, both the coming and the going. There's one tame crow that sleeps in the attic eaves. She came and took it and fed it meal soaked with liquor until it fell asleep, compliant. The crows now sacrifice themselves to the woman. It is a way of saying thank you when there are no other gifts to give, because the beets ran out, and then the beans. The girl, her bag, a pouch, some sort of textile tension that suspends a burden, the crow. And later, on the plate, they will place this burden into themselves, suspend it in their guts. Today, the rain, an inverted sea, a mess to get through it, cold, painful, despair, in love with gravity. Up there on the hill is an old woman. She is a human horseshoe, pried off the battle-weary hoof and lost, rusting. An osteoporotic woman oxidizing within the saline mist. She stands on the heights of this dark mound and watches for ships that do not come. Her every finger and apparatus cocked for curing tumors, sausages, curses. The old woman stands at the deep square trenches dug along the coastal forest ridge. These Nazi fortifications seem the graves of some geometric god. They are filled with mysteries for killing. If such weapons pits house a furied god, who made this land his altar? Underneath the flap of skin, let's call it a tear, where inside something's flickering. A rip in the epidermis, embroider the membrane, decorate the opening like an about-to-be bride. Make it a grandmother stitch of doilies and faded daisies. Beauty woven through disaster. Pull each thread of it tight and nick it with the teeth. Just a snip of the lips so it's white and wet, The mouth is a pocket of wind and wanting, and also of words. It smells of a mother licking its young, one tongue or two, accommodating. Just a flip of muscle, a flap of skin there we call a cheek, the sag that goes taut with shrieking. She is so hungry she uses the side of a fish for a mirror. She isn't divining the topology of her features or longing to confine the sweetness in her fleeting greed. One silver fish and laid against it a pair of late potatoes and a cut of bread. In the shining sides of the fish, the mirror, the tubers become four, the bread, a loaf, pike, herring, beans, as if there is finally enough. How it feels in winter, eating only what is white. When the end is near, gather close to the old woman, become small as sand, and cling within her wrinkles. Later, some will say, oh, they have built a hut of sea-washed wood along the dunes. It guards against the sand attacks. It is a house made for old women. Forget this. When the end is near, gather close to the old woman and be gathered into her arms. Be wrapped by her legs like the loved is wrapped by lover, like tree by vine. When the end comes, it is bone, not wood, that will protect us. We have so little to work with here. We live in houses where woman flesh erodes from bone. Climb inside a woman and wait for her bones to build a house. Her arms and legs, the pylons. Look, we have built a hut of sea-washed woman along the dunes. It is a house made of old woman. In the summers, the green snakes once slept with us in curls, fresh as ferns. They were as much among us then as men, whose hands were for creation. The crows slept safely in our eaves. There were moments of still once, when the tide pulsed within its bounds of vein or dune. The linden tree, the birch, and the rue grew roots to embrace the buried. There is another way of staying unmarried. The girl has not returned from fishing. The bees weave a thatch of wax, and with them it sticks, collects. Whereas with us, all is precarious. We leave holes, not footprints. A fletch of salt-soaked crowbone in the sand and silt.
This is Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. You've been listening to Quintan Ana Wikswo reading from The Hope of Floating Has Carried Us This Far. Quintan Ana Wikswo, would you talk about the poetics of your books, your use of language and image, the ways your books are constructed, the ways you utilize space? Talk about how they were conceived and constructed.
Yes, absolutely. So the novel, A Long Curling Star Where the Heart Should Be, neither of them were written with the expectation of publishing them, or publication was the last on my mind. I mean, as in terms of producing a book for an audience, or God forbid, a commodity for a marketplace. So there were just conventions I'm wildly unaware of. I mean, I have an MFA, for what that's worth. I have a college degree, but I think, you know, I was also raised in the backwoods with the King James Bible, and there's just, to me, writing both of those books was something very ancient. I've been reading a lot of Alejandra Pizarnik's work.
Oh, I love her work.
Oh, I'm just besotted. And she keeps saying how ancient this is, how ancient this is. And I think because I had no need or interest to locate either of the books contemporarily, and they ended up being experimental and like very contemporary or something, but it was just because the way we process or that many of us process things that are bigger than us is faltering and jagged and circular. I have admiration for those who can write according to the narrative arc and the European traditions of the novel and the essay, but it's not how I experience expression or meaning or life. And so open space to me in a book is a time to think. It's introducing the element of time to literature in a way that forces a pause but also permits a pause. Mm-hmm. Because I didn't go to school, I just devoured books far beyond my years from the library, and I would, you know, be like 8 and trying to read Love in the Time of Cholera and I'd make it through a paragraph and then have to stop for 30 minutes to just sit with that paragraph. And I think that's what really influenced a lot of the space and a lot of the photographs, because the rich, just, it's a multi-sensory, language is multi-sensory. Mm-hmm. And we cruise through it because it's a vernacular. There's street signs. We're completely inundated with text around us, particularly now. The amount of language that's hurled at us that we have to consume, process, and in some way integrate so quickly, mm-hmm. so much so quickly. And for me, they're having worked, and I live at these sites, the human rights sites, for long periods of time, and a lot of it is sitting there speechless. A lot of it is talking to someone and not being able to say a word for a day afterwards or something. So the idea of just hurtling through anything of meaning doesn't work for me. And so I think that's the rhythm and the expectation that one need not hurry is something that matters to me in literature very much.
So are these books kind of processors?
Absolutely. The novel was written over an extremely long period of time, and it's basically a family history, thinly disguised family history. Mm-hmm. And then the short stories I wrote in the field, basically everywhere that I was on a project, it was just to kind of come home and, I don't know, get contact with, send a signal out to some. What is it when you write? Are you writing to a particular person sometimes? Are you writing for a feeling sometimes? You know, something is nagging at the writer to take this kind of chemical reaction that's happening inside the brain and the psyche and somehow make it tangible. It's such an absurd practice. Yeah, it's such an absurd thing to think that we could do that. And so these were incredibly intense times for me and incredibly intense feelings, and the hope of floating has carried us this far. It's a bit more fragmented, because it was written in the whirlwind, and it was written as a secret. I do have to say absolutely the most heartfelt shout out to the renaissance of the independent presses in this country right now that are saving our souls, what's left of them.
Hear, hear.
Because it's astonishing to me that that visionary editors and visionary presses are often seen as adversaries, when they are our allies, the independent ones that will take leaps into the abyss.
Absolutely, absolutely. Small presses with big ideas do all the heavy lifting. Quintan, you've long engaged sites of atrocity, and the hope of floating has carried us this far, deeply engages these realms. And the book has many photographs of these self-same places. Would you talk about your interest in, your concern with these places?
Yes. I think what we're finding is that patterns that we think have dissolved over time don't really dissolve, they just crystallize. So a lot of my work as a human rights field worker and as a writer is looking at the structure of those crystals, that crystalline structure of what still lingers in place and kind of the emotional ecology and the physical ecology, and listening to what the land says in places where people have been betrayed by their fellow humans.
How did you come to start doing this work, this human rights field work?
Oh, I was really young and faked my age I had early access to the DARPANET, which predated the internet.
Mm-hmm.
And so I started working. I grew up in the South and I didn't go to school. So instead of going to school, I worked with veteran civil rights activists, the people who marched on Selma. No one realized that they were like in the 70s and 80s and 90s, these people are still at it. So I worked locally because of what was happening in my community in terms of bigotry and the Klan and everything. And then once I got a hold of DARPANET, it was during a lot of the, they thought I was older, so I worked for Amnesty International in South America and Central America doing work around genocide and children and the disappearances. So it's always been I've always had a very local, intimate focus on exactly where I am, and then another eye on the fact that this is happening everywhere.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody has a monopoly on, no community has a monopoly on its capacity to do the unfathomable.
Indeed. And were you always writing and documenting and engaging it artistically as well?
No, I mean, my specialty has been really working with, professionally, my expertise is working with sites and situations that are especially fraught and especially delicate. And so a lot of that was writing reports and taking oral histories and survivor testimonies and perpetrator testimonies, and working a great deal with, actually, rather than the survivors of human rights atrocities, and to actually spend a great deal of time with the perpetrators themselves, which has always been a big part of my life.
What's the value of engaging the perpetrators' thoughts?
To answer that roundabout, I started out wanting to study peace and justice studies in university, and then I decided it made more sense to major in military studies, because if I wanted to understand how things are structured and executed, I had to go to the people and institutions that had the capacity to actually orchestrate massive crimes against humanity. So I think the value of people steer away from it, the survivors and victims are equally important, but I think the ability to actually see the faces and the body movements and the gestures, and it transforms the work completely to realize that there are individuals who are making decisions, who are walking around. It's not some anonymous Borg of evil,
Mm-hmm.
These are human beings that are doing this. And if we dehumanize anybody, the whole thing falls apart,
Mm-hmm.
They're as human as the people that they're dehumanizing. I started writing poetry and fiction basically in order to psychiatrically survive.
Because
there's a lot that I couldn't actually talk about. And there's the inchoate language that is far more intimate than what a white paper or a newspaper article or a report can actually convey, and I needed to have that decanted.
And in addition to the prose, the fiction and poetry, there's also the photographs and performances.
Yes. And films. So I have two films that are getting ready to tour the US and Europe that I'm very excited about, and I do librettos for those. And so collaboration is really important to me. I'm stubborn. I like doing things my own way, but I really love the friction of working closely with other people's visions.
What happens that doesn't otherwise happen?
I get pushed and they get pushed. I think there tends to be particularly, when we first start out as expressive beings, writers, artists, everything is wide open, and we tend to get smaller and smaller and smaller the older we get. Mm-hmm. You know, somehow the ferocity dies down and we just become so small. And this is what I can do, this is what I can't do, this is what I should do, this is what I shouldn't do, this is what I can say, this is what I can't. And when you're in that moiba strip, you can go around forever. But when that strip is kind of cut and attached to another strip, you're walking along and all of a sudden you're in a different experience. You're pushed into someone else's intimate, like, work that's unfinished. To be part of someone else's unfinished artwork is such a blessing. It's like some sort of creation of a star. It's just messy and not clear what's going on, and the intimacy that comes from all of us allowing each other into that space of creation, I think you find out things about yourself. Yeah.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Ways of seeing, and I'm very much interested by the way in which, in a lot of ways, prose has these distinctions between poetry and prose has lost so much of its rhythmic, the rhythmic attention that working with a composer, and everything is time. It's a sound to time. It's a sound to time. And that has influenced my writing so deeply. The structure of musical notes is exactly like an alphabet, you know, and it does unfold over time, particularly when it's spoken, or depending on how you read it, or how you need to manipulate the text so that the rhythm that you hear as a writer is a rhythm that transfers to the reader.
Speaking of beauty woven within disaster, Holdfast Crowbiter is so beautifully written, attentive to the sonorities, the musicality of language. Please talk about the tensions in the book between the beauty of the language, the beauty of its imagery, and the horrors of the various terrible events described.
I remember being very, very young in rural North Carolina, and my brother and I were wandering around and came upon a really beautiful piece of land. It was absolutely gorgeous, and had streams and trees, and there was a bobcat in the trees. I mean, it was just magical and beautiful. And we kept walking, and an old man came out to meet us and introduced himself. And even though he had been born after slavery, he had not been told. So this was in the mid-80s, and he had been born and lived his whole life on the plantation, which was abandoned. And he took us downstairs and showed us his mother's leg irons. And I think at that moment, something in me irrevocably changed, because you expect horror to look like horror. Mm-hmm. You know, we're conditioned that predators look like predators. Mm-hmm. And danger looks like danger, and evil looks like evil, and mm-hmm. all these things can be easily diagnosed and identified. And then what went wrong that we couldn't tell? You know, it looked like a beautiful farm, and beauty is an integral part, because I don't think there can, part of the horror is that the beauty of existence is defiled. They walk hand in hand. What's been taken, what's been destroyed, and what's, I don't know, still, what's still there. And there are few places where I felt more simultaneously alive and dead than at sites where people's souls have been wrenched from them, and that's a fundamental severing. And the severing, the fissure between horror and beauty, I think, is huge. I mean, beauty is beauty. It's sublime, and horror is it's an aversion, it's disgusting, and yet there they are together. And then when people are ripped from their psyches through human cruelty, I think there's that fissure that makes no sense either. why is this? Why? And that's the friction of why. How can all of this coexist? How can we do it like this? My dog is snorting her commentary.
I hear her. I hear her. It's wonderful. I feel like I need to ask her some questions too. Chekhov said something like, every man is ashamed in front of a dog, or ought to be.
Yes. Yes, hallelujah to that.
Thought for a long time, but never vocalized it, that dogs are the best people.
They are. And part of it's having a service. I mean, I've long had a soft spot for strays and rehabilitated racetrack greyhounds when I lived in Mexico, and abandoned coy wolves in, you know, the middle of nowhere in New Mexico, and these feral animals, and then the amount of love that they provide is so superior to what most humans are capable of even beginning to give, you know.
Unconditional love.
Mm-hmm. And loyalty and sympathy. I mean, they don't know what it's like to be a human, and any more than we know what it's like to be a dog, and yet somehow they come and provide comfort. They don't have to. Why? it's an act of grace.
So much is evacuated in gashes and wet tissues. That line made me think that the piece very much teaches you how to read it, with all of its spaces and gashes in a way on the page. Another thing that came to mind was you talked about the body mollusk and bones building the house of an old woman, kind of these transformations, these spatial transformations. I thought of Bachelard and Poetics of Space. And there are mentionings of orifices and voids, and the insides have come out. The mouth is a pocket of wind and wanting. The book itself is, it seems to be evacuating its insides.
Yes, absolutely. And there's a membrane that kind of holds reality together for all of us who are trying to experience this thing called life. You know, we all agree that blue is blue, or whatever the membrane is that provides the surface tension to allow us to not scream in panic at 4 o'clock every morning, which many of us do anyway. But, you know, I'm interested in the moments when the membrane, almost like Einstein's, when it warps and what belongs on one side moves over to the other side. What is contained becomes uncontained. What is uncontained is suddenly contained. You know, how do you take existence out of its boxes and take experience and sight out of what we've been trained to see and feel and actually experience it for yourself? I mean, people take hallucinogens, presumably, to do that, but you could also just be a really disturbed poet and achieve the same result.
Speaking of poets, who are some writers that have informed your approach? You mentioned Alejandra, Pizarnik. I'm curious to hear some others.
Yeah, I mean,
other writers in general and artists.
The early work of Tacita, her visual art, her erasure pieces that she drew on blackboards and on the veins of alabaster. I love her early work. British visual artist. I have been rereading Margaret Parker. There are more beautiful things than Beyonce. The deep influences are, without question, the Torah and the Bible, the King James Bible and the Torah. Those texts are deeply embedded in everything for me.
Which version of the King James Bible? The 1611?
Yes.
I have mine. I had the audacity of asking Gordon Lish to sign it, my copy, and he did.
I mean, who do you really get to sign a Bible? You know, I mean, that would be kind of an interesting performance piece. Could you please sign this for me? The person who almost runs you over on the street, you know, the person who picks up the dollar bill that you dropped and gives it back.
Yeah.
Sign my Bible. No, I love God, Gene Toomer and Kane.
Oh, yes.
Mm-hmm. And I am so delighted that it was finally reissued. It's coming. I think he was so far ahead of his time and so...
Absolutely.
In a way that, I guess that's kind of a cliche, ahead of his time, but so much of who he was as a person, as well as his texts, were unwieldy, were concepts that couldn't be processed by people at the time. His views on race and narrative and everything must have seemed, I mean, no wonder the work was buried for so long. I think now is the perfect time for the new edition to come out. I hope that there is more translations of the women writers, especially of South America and France, Hélène, Cixous, and there's so many.
Oh, yes.
I mean, like Alejandra, whose work is just languishing through lack of having an English edition. And Aimé Césaire,
yes.
The book of the return to the native land, is a cornerstone book for me. Then I would say definitely Encountering Zora, Neale Hurston,
mm-hmm.
was a mother language, and Paul Celan.
Oh my God, yes.
I live so much of my life out of suitcases, but those always come with me. I may not have sufficient socks, but I definitely have the poetry that I need.
I definitely wish Toomer were read more and discussed more. Kane, yes, but also his book of aphorisms, which is brilliant.
The man can just floor you in the power of such control over language and meaning and nuance in a compact space for someone who understands both the abstraction and conceptualism within the heart of poetry and the need to convey meaning that is within the heart of prose. He takes these two parts of his brain and just one sentence just slays you. It's phenomenal work.
Would you say that Toomer's approach to form also influenced your work? His blending of poetry and prose and autobiography and short story? Do you think that informed your practice too?
You know, my practice was so feral. I've never taken an English class in my entire life, which I'm not quite sure how I swung that, but I don't. I think everything has soaked in, everything that's made me feel intensely has soaked in and had an impact, and especially people who were so clearly writing for their own freedom, I mean, their own agency and this intimacy with their internal world and this kind of massive lack of pandering to the marketplace, you know, to what tastes provide. But when you read Aimé Césaire, and I mean, it's his only real book. He goes on to have quite the phenomenal political career, obviously.
Yeah.
But the people who have seen that. I don't see literature or self-expression. I don't think artists have to do political work. I don't think writers have an obligation to write to our times or our identities or anything. But when we choose to do so, and the writers who do, like Celan's work, and mm-hmm. the Spectre, those who do have a unparalleled power that I think, particularly now, we mm-hmm. need very badly. And it's good to see so many people reinvesting their emotional labor into humanitarian work.
Why do we need such writers in writing?
There are people who are... I had a teacher once, I studied with the Sikhs for a really long time, and I had a teacher once, and he said there are fire keepers and there are fire starters. And the fire keepers don't know how to light a fire. All they can do is tend the fire. And the fire starters, once they've started the fire, they're useless. You know, and figure out which one you are. And we need both now, because things need to be everything that's been hidden is just being revealed, and then within secrets are more secrets, and our country, what we've done to our ecology, you know, this kind of sleeping poisons that have completely altered an entire planet and the universe. Like, it's astonishing that humans can have that level of impact on each other. And as a writer, you can do that too. I mean, you may not want to. It may not be a desire. It's perfectly lovely to have a book to take on vacation. One of my favorite bookstores, I mean, well, actually my favorite bookstore in the entire universe that I'm aware of is Unnameable Books.
Oh, in Brooklyn. Wow.
Yeah. I used to walk there every time I needed out of special kind of hope for the future. And I was going on a holiday, which is something I don't do, and I needed all these books. And he said, "Oh dear, what happened? You know, was there a death?" I said, "No. This is my holiday reading." And he said, "Where are you going?" And I said, "Cape Cod." I don't think that's what these books were written for. And, you know, I lasted on Cape Cod for 36 hours, and then the books and I went home and were quite happy with each other, but he was right. They didn't belong together. So I'm glad that there are people writing all sorts of different things. But for those of us who have feel any sense of responsibility or urgency to take responsibility for the direction of human behavior, to hold to accountability, to be a conscience of any kind, even just to ask the simplest questions, now is the time. And it's an, you know, again, like Alejandra said, it how ancient this is, scribes, and, you know, and somehow now we're extraneous. We're not extraneous. You know, we're the seers.
When you say asking, the importance of asking the most basic questions, I once was at a Salman Rushdie reading and I asked him a series of questions. And after he was done answering them, he said, "Can anybody just ask me what my favorite color is?"
Yes.
So what's your favorite color?
My favorite color would be fuchsia. I love fuchsia, and if somehow I could dip fuchsia in gold and make it a whole new color, it might be that.
It also sounds like future.
Yes. I like colors that are absolutely improbable. I mean, there's in New Mexico, by my house is, I have an arroyo behind my house, and, you know, in New Mexico, the arroyo is where you keep everything, you know, so it's like an attic for, I guess the wasp equivalent would be an attic. we have arroyos, so they become these kind of scrapbooks. So anyway, it's always fun to go, you know, jaunting through an arroyo and see what odd things people have put down there. And occasionally you'll see something really, really bright. And you go, "Oh, it's a piece of plastic. Oh, what might this be?" And you go down and it's actually a lichen. It's actually a cactus. It's something that has come out of the natural world and has the most artificial looking color. And I think fuchsia is improbable like that. I like those crazy chartreuse lichen and lava. I mean, these are incredible colors.
Speaking of incredible colors, like the hope of floating has carried us this far, A Long Curving Scar Where the Heart Should Be, published by Stalking Horse Press, also has vivid photographs, and I wonder if you might read from it.
I would love to. So it is very deeply based in my family history, which is my mother's family history, which is actually, I am looking down the street at the street where my great-grandfather died of syphilis, which plays a major part in the book. And it was here that the brothel that he worked at was located. So it's it's an interesting thing to write my novel and look at and realize that that's where I'm off yet. I wrote the book before I had actually come to where he lived, but he's an actual person. And these people are actual people. So Sweet Marie is one of the two sisters who are daughters of Lafayette and Ma in this story about women rebuilding themselves, their bodies, their autonomy with very few resources. So the book takes place in the 1930s, and my family has a contentiously mixed race history, and a lot of what the women are dealing with in this book are that as well. So at the time, she's on the train to New York, and we forget they were segregated sometimes now as we travel along that route from Virginia up to New York. It was not always a very peaceful experience for people fleeing the constraints and going towards something new. And my first trip to New York as a Southerner from the backwoods of nowhere was on a train, and it was magnificent. So this kind of comes from that, the epic journey of a lot of things. And like everywhere in the country, the South is a very interesting place to be right. I'm also looking at a Confederate monument, and the foyer of my apartment has a gigantic portrait of Jefferson Davis. So,
my God,
you don't go too far into the future here without the past dragging you back, whether you like it or not. So I think in this chapter, Sweet Marie is desperately trying to move into the future and has chosen a train to do that on. So it's called Nocturne for the Hollow Swan. Unlike the other women in her family, Sweet Marie didn't particularly care for drink, but she found it interesting. The scent of gin in a bottle just opened reminded her of winter, of dead trees. She was drinking it on a rare, swift trip to New York, temporarily freed in order to retrieve a new patient, when something unfamiliar stirred in her. The way the dirty snow formed a blanket of quiet filth across miles upon miles of striving city life. The way the drink went down cold with ice as the train quivered on its tracks. The juniper taste of it, the cut-branched moan of the crushed ice in her glass, and around it, the dull hum of the tracks and the passengers' voices muted together in a loose pain of communion. Strangers together, canned as summer apples, a grim cigar streaming smoke in the lounge car, old wool dampened with sweat, the sounds of longing, of striving to reach city and money and luck. All that from a glass of gin bought for her in the dining car by a jazz girl she should know not to, but Sweet Marie didn't care about those things, even though people thought she would, from the outside, thought she would care about the rules of society. But she was too gone, far out of the reaches of the world for that. And besides, the gin stirred something in her, swift and shimmering liquid, or was it the girl who stirred her? The jazz girl shouted out to her friends, long, loud, often, head back and mouth cracked, wet and wide, arms flung, cigarette in one hand and then the other, lighting four cigarettes in her mouth at once for her friends and passing them down the line, eyes crinkling into a slow wink, a wink surely directed at Sweet Marie, and kneeling down beside her, suddenly, a hand on the smoldering crease at Sweet Marie's hip. Oh, how this bright, shining, copper-colored girl spoke to her, expansive, huge, thickly low-voiced, as tremendous as the sea at night, mysterious and glistening. The jazz girl and her band were on their way to the next gig, a club, somewhere in Harlem or Greenwich Village or somewhere. The girl's rhythmic intonation of the city's names and foreign neighborhoods as remote as heaven or hell to Sweet Marie. Deep within the pockets of the South, she had no idea of their import, but sensed their resonance. The jazz girl brought Sweet Marie another drink. She carried their two glasses in long, wide steps. Heels sunk down into the carpet with each step mannish, as though even the floor she still sank with purpose into the mud of the earth. Her front teeth slightly gapped, white and wet as a mussel shell cracked open, a smile glowing in the light. She shone, luminous, a midnight water snake. She slammed closer and closer to Sweet Marie, encircling, whirling, mesmerizing her. How? Was it all happening very quickly or very slowly, or was it not happening at all? As the girl spoke softly to her in that smoldering tobacco voice, Sweet Marie inhaled unevenly, trying to catch the girl's breath, trying to capture it, that fire-flung scent. What was it? So rare, syrupy and strong, warm, brown thing, a forest smell caught up with salt and sea, a Carolina coast of swamp and saline and cypress woods. The jazz girl carried a saxophone and a violin. She showed Sweet Marie the block of golden wax used to calm its strings. Her hands were rough, but small, capable beyond her narrow wrists. Her fingers long, their base and tipped, callous-skinned, small, cropped fingernails, flat and shiny as picks. The bones of her face cradled the instrument, exquisite to Sweet Marie's devouring gaze. A man's cotton shirt half concealed her breast, rich and full, heavy, soft, rounded, so perfect. Sweet Marie imagined her nipples like the nubs of antlers on spring fawns, a velveted firmness. Eyes centered, brown, burning out to a young green, keenly intelligent and sexed. Your song, the jazz girl murmured to Sweet Marie, your soul. And suddenly Marie looked down in fright at the girl's small, beautiful hand resting on her own pathetic, stretched and shrunk dress and felt tremendously sad. Sweet Marie was another bit of the world's detritus to this girl. This girl could see no more song or soul in Sweet Marie than in a shred of lint at the bottom of a pocket. The girl was like the others. How could she truly know or care about the secrets of Sweet Marie? Sweet Marie grew so afraid. She wanted this girl, yet she had trained herself so well to scab over, to tend to her leprous, numbed parts, to be hard and fierce and unfeeling. She feared what it was to love, to be part of something great and passionate, important and powerful, when she herself was so strange and alone, so easily and thoughtlessly blown down, trampled and forgotten. Sweet Marie had learned to use her cold exterior to slowly extinguish the warm and tender, vulnerable thing inside her that she once knew. This girl, something about this jazz girl's coal fire touch, the focus of her eyes, hinted at the presence of something unexpectedly amazing. There was a rare something illuminating her from within, something that could utter a call that would bring forth what Sweet Marie had long concealed. And in the face of that, Sweet Marie felt herself dangerously humbled. But somehow, Sweet Marie accepted the girl's drink and felt a strange, low vibration carry through to her heart as though from a very great distance. It took 2 days to reach New York City, and one night, Sweet Marie had planned to sleep in her seat. Her body had formed itself to its armature over the course of the day. But then she began to feel less comfortable instead of more, and she went to the lounge car. She denied any desire to see the girl. But the jazz girl sat in the seat across the aisle. The musicians were talking quiet and high in the car, the windows dark against the night, and the passengers' faces shining with oil, reflected, became spirits, peering in at them. The jazz girl was polishing her saxophone, rubbing it down with a purple velvet cloth worn bare in the places where her fingers often went. At dusk, the train had crossed state lines into Maryland, and now those awake at night could rise from their seats and mingle, the dark-skinned and the white, and those whose flesh fell someplace in between. Sweet Marie and the jazz girl talked into the shared air between them, undisturbed. A sleeping car cost extra, but the jazz girl paid with change. Sweet Marie saw everything about her shining, the brass of her saxophone, the coins in the girl's hand, the sheen on her teeth and damp lips. The jazz burl touched Sweet Marie like a note, drawing blood into her body, so she felt a sudden heaviness of breast and thigh, the way it is the first time water courses through the copper of a new pipe. And then the girl's hands were an electric storm, enveloping her body, crashing and howling, a crescendo snapping branches and hurling sticks and leaves into the drowned air, a pelting of embraces, fingers so deep in Sweet Marie's muscles, pulling her leg up behind the knee, unlocking her fingers there in the hollow, a hurricane tumble, and Marie falling into the rain, becoming a droplet, a stinging nettle of water mixing with this jazz girl, pouring wet, dripping, Sweet Marie's own pale rain running down the backs of her thighs, her dress wet. This was new, after all, new. It was suddenly not like anything before, hailstones falling, a shower of pearls. The girl's lips large and sweet, hungry, delicious, endless. They held Sweet Marie above and below, released, took hold. These active, live, and lovely things, Sweet Marie had to feel the girl's mouth, run her fingers along the ridges of her lips, feel the wetness, the groove down the center, force them open to run her finger along the surface of her teeth, feel them suck and bite. This was completely new, completely different. Sweet Marie's body shook. Skin plucked and strummed, pummeled by new feeling.
This is Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. You have been listening to Quintan Ana Wikswo reading from A Long Curving Scar Where the Heart Should Be, a book which Lydia Yuknovich says, quote, peels back history to image, lyric, and the body so viscerally, unquote, and Jeff Vandermeer calls, quote, beautiful, passionate, and bold, unquote, and I wholeheartedly agree. While there are many connections to your previous book, The Hope of Floating has carried us this far, Quintan. There are the fissures, ruins, voids, and the body among bodies. Your approach to sentences is quite different in this book. You've exchanged ellipses and elegiac brevity for long, sprawling, elaborate sentences. Why did you take this approach for this book?
I would have to say nothing is short in the South.
I mean, I thought of Faulkner reading this too.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I don't.
Oh, and Leon Forrest.
I have to write him down.
Oh, I think you will. I think you will love him. African American writer. He has a trilogy. It's called the Forrest County Trilogy. The first one is called There Is a Tree More Ancient Than Eden. His I know you also love, I love long titles, and I know you do too, so he's just on a whole different plane.
Oh, I can't wait. I'm gonna track those.
Oh, I think you'll love it. I think you'll love it. Nothing is short in the South, you said.
Nothing is short in the South. Nothing is short. I for a long time in New York, I did a lot of these works. I mean, I most of my writing, I perform first, so it's an oral. It's really an oral form for me. And I've worked for many, many years with the composer and bassist Arthur Kell. He runs Bar Lunatico in Bed-Stuy right now. He's fantastic. Before Cornelia Street got destroyed by New York, we used to go there a lot, and he would get very frustrated because he's a Yankee, and he would ask me a question, and 15 minutes later, the answer would appear. And we started traveling together in Germany doing the book that I'm now writing, and he started a timer. He's like, I'm going to ask you a question, and you have either 3 seconds or 3 sentences to answer. And I was like, you don't understand, and I'm just not editor. We have this process, and I think the short story collection is from a different kind of. I mean, like, Europe has been fractured over and over and over and over again. It is shards upon shards upon shards. I mean, you know, you're walking down the street in Vilnius, or, you know, God knows where, in Estonia, and there's, you know, you kick open a piece of dirt and Lafayette's. A medal from one of Lafayette's soldiers' bodies comes out. You're like, why is this? The number of shatterings across how long that land has been occupied by people who left a very strong material culture is just like, to me, it is fragments. It's bone fragments. It's nothing but fragments. And so writing that book had to be this continual heartbreak, particularly in Eastern Europe, where people have gone back and forth and back and forth, slaughtering each other for thousands and thousands and thousands of years, and there aren't any whole pieces left. And I think there's something about the South and these women who are compressed. I mean, I think people in the South in general are very compressed in what is an incredibly fertile land. I mean, this summer I stayed in the writer John McManus's house for a couple months to write, and while he was away, and he's a fabulous writer, and he has some kind of vine, and overnight it would grow across the door. How does a vine grow 2 feet in the space of, you know, when I go to bed at 3 a.m. and wake up at 7? But that's that, and I think this desire to press outward and the constant constraints, and to me, I think it was partially conscious. Actually, it was quite conscious, I think, to alter the rhythm and the form and the architecture that contain the language to be very place-based. And these women are compressed. And to give a book that, especially about female sexuality, and especially in Southern Gothic, that is so invokes race and sex and gender so deeply, and yet there are, you know, it's Faulkner and Tennessee Williams, and, you know, we can get away. There's a lot of explicit eroticism in the novel, and I have one of my favorite books is Cormac McCarthy's Suttree.
Oh yeah.
You know, and the filthiness, the absolutely gorgeous filthiness of a lot of his early work that's mm-hmm. just mm-hmm. you know, raw and kind of fetid, and like where is the room for where are the women? So I wanted to just let them go. And I've also always been very interested to nerd out a bit on theory of this Monique VT talking about mm-hmm. The narrative structure, you know, the narrative arc as a male orgasm, and the circle, the circular structure as the female orgasm, where the stories, the text peaks and peaks again and peaks again and peaks again, and then you go back to the beginning, and those are the books you read 20,000 times because they're a continuous strip of orgasm. And I think for, oh yes, the dog definitely has to be. So I think I wanted the women to have that space that is denied to us, take up all the page, and to be too much. I mean, it's an obnoxious book. It's too much. The page is too long. The sentences are too long. They're too thick. Everything about it is excessive. And that was intentional. And like I said, I didn't expect it to be published, so I didn't care.
Sometimes too much is not enough. Reminds me of Stanley Elkin, another writer I adore, who said, less is less, more is more, enough is enough. Any of his books are just killer. Another writer that came to mind, and actually a lot as I'm thinking about this, is John Hawkes, who once said, everything I have written comes out of nightmare, out of the nightmare of war, I think. Another thing he said was, I began to write fiction on the assumption that the true enemies of the novel were plot, character, setting, and theme. And having once abandoned these familiar ways of thinking about fiction, totality of vision or structure was really all that remained.
Oh, God, that's gorgeous. You know, the first quote that you read from Hawks about war, mm-hmm. and I think it's dawning on a larger portion of the population that women's lives are a war zone.
Yes.
I mean, there really is and has been a very, very violent war against women. And it is worse in some places than others, or it manifests differently in some places than others. But the value of a woman in the South was initially on the auction block, you know, or paid women Europe and bought by Jamestown settlers. You know, I mean, just there's a lot of anger in that book of feeling like my existence and the existence of really all of the women that I knew in the South being so completely truncated. That, yes, the idea of the female orgasm and that women would continue on and continue on and continue on and we couldn't just be sort of stomped out. I don't know. There was an underlying political agenda in there. moral agenda, ethical, humanist, I don't know.
And in erotics?
Yes, yes. And that is something I wish that we didn't. I mean, it's such a vulnerable, strange thing, and it's such a, you know, it's funny, you think, you know, the tropes of love poetry mm-hmm. and the poets who are known for their erotic poetry, and they're kind of in this little catacomb all off to themselves, as if no one else will quite dare to go there, but we're all in that terrain. I would love to see more kind of body realness, for lack of a better phrase, in what we write, more embodiment, and especially around sex. I just find it very surprising. There's still this kind of prurient fear in American literature that I think we really desperately need to overcome.
A lot of the
writers that are doing phenomenal work right now around, you know, what may be tertiary identity or something is also about embodiment. And I mean, Morgan Parker, mm-hmm. her work, there are a lot of, especially women, that I hope publishers recognize that. I mean, it was very difficult to place A Long Perfect Scar Where the Heart Should Be directly because of the female sexuality. I mean, that was cited by many publishers as the reason why they were not comfortable publishing it.
Why is it taboo?
I don't know why. Apparently, you know, I was basically told again and again, and my agent was told again and again, that men don't want to read about female sexuality from a female point of view, and women are appalled by reading. You know, there's no marketplace. It's not saleable. What's marketable is sex from a male perspective, heterosexual sex from a male perspective, in no uncertain terms. I mean, it was very clearly like, we can't take the erotics out of your book, and we cannot sell it with the erotics in the book. And it's lovely, but it's explicit, and that's not, you know, James, being fearless, didn't care. Stalking Horse Press, which is a very lovely home for that book.
Would you read from your forthcoming book, Quintan?
Yes. The new book is entitled The Slaughter Parties, and I'm not sure where the powers that be will place it in terms of discipline or genre. but as far as I'm concerned, it's an autobiography, and it's surrounding the internal culture of first responders to human rights crises and what it is to inhabit a world that is constantly shattered, and what that does to us over time. So this is the introduction, and it's called Broken Elegies, The New Unforgetting. The first elegy. There are bystanders today, like always. They arrive as the clouds cover the sun. The bystanders, with their glow that dims out the stars. There are bystanders today, like always. There are the watchers today, like always, who so shut their eyes, like always. They arrive at dusk. They arrive at the new moon. There are the watchers. They arrive at the dark with their eyes, as always, stitched shut. There are the watchers today, like always, who so shut their eyes. There are the listeners today, like always, who cover their ears. They arrive with their balls of cotton. There are the listeners with their wads of cotton, how carefully they insert the cotton. The listeners arrive carrying armfuls of silence. The listeners mute the birds, the great silencing of the spirits. the listeners have arrived, and see how they cover their ears and smother the spirits of the birds with their armfuls of cotton. There are the speakers today, as always, who so closed their lips. They arrive as a tindled wisp of steam, rising from the hollows in the mountainside. The speakers have arrived, with strings hanging from behind their teeth, their mouths stitched shut. The speakers, their throats throttled, words hidden, deep as the hollows in the mountainside at dawn with the rising of a winter solstice sun. There are the dwellers today, like always, the dwellers who cannot leave, the witnesses, the warriors, the survivors who refuse to leave, the dwellers, the warriors, the survivors, the witnesses, as always, who do not arrive because there was never a leave-taking. The dwellers who will not leave and will not take, and we have no lids on our eyes, no lips to our mouths, we have no hands for our ears, and the warriors, the dwellers, the ones who are here, have arrived, although we have never left. Walk through the snow in bare feet, the patterns of foot soles melting the soil to reveal the scarlet blood underneath. The way the bodies curl, a furled stalk, then unwind into my hand. The way my body, an unfurled sprout, curls and then winds into my hand. The second elegy. The new unforgetting, beings and beings and being, pushing up from below the frozen stones. It is true what they say, how difficult it is to really know what has happened here. The third elegy. This is how I come calling. This is the company I keep. This is the sound of my lungs expelling air, a gasp, a sigh, a cry. This is the sound of my fingers in my mouth, vomiting, unsilencing. This is the hollow of my throat in the darkness. This is my finger opening the lid. This is my gut rising. This is the skin in my lungs. This is the flesh of my teeth. This is the crimes of humanity against humanity that occur without ceasing, without remembering, without forgetting, without changing, without not changing. A constant turning of the soil to reveal new, old bones, and new bones, and old, new bones. And this soil we inhabit, this is the earth upon which we dwell. These are the streets we walk. This is the crime we commit. This is. There is a repetition in the attempt to rescue, reveal, heal. The process does not begin, and it does not end. I do it over. I come, and I come again. I do it, and then I do it over. I do it, and do it, and do it until it's almost right. And yet, it is never right, not quite. And so the process does not begin, and does not end. And then I do it again in hopes it will be over. And I say, it's over, but it's never over. So I do it again, this time right, but there is no right. Next elegy. We come upon more evidence of human inhumanity. It is a ceaseless feed, a body of Ouroboros for all time and all place. There is recognition. Thinking follows knowing. Feeling surrounds. Thinking follows knowing, there is recognition, feeling surrounds, there is knowing with the feeling long before the thought. I saw what secrets are here, and I thought, I ought not. I ought not, I think, and then I recognize this place, and I think, I know what happened here. I have come, and I have come again, and again, and again to this place, and time that is without beginning, as it is without end, and I cannot arrive, and I cannot go. Let's say I try to leave, to forget, to pretend. Let's say I saw what secrets are here, and I thought, I ought not, I think, and then I recognize this place, and I think, I know. I feel I must. And so, you see, there is no leaving. no forgetting, no pretending what is forever is and cannot unbe. Elegy. The viscera, the placenta kicked from an unfinished womb. Rip it, tear it, tear it, tear, rend it heel to toe, head to heel, toe to head, head to heel. This is what our species has always done, what is done to the young. Maybe the predator begins, softly, with a grace. Let me touch your body while you are sleeping. I will rip off limbs. You will like the limp. I'm going to peel you open from the toes, separate the bones, all of them. Don't stop at one or two. Won't stop until I've disassembled you. Crack apart your wrist, your spine, your ribs, the viscera, the placenta. I will bite it off. I saw what secrets are in you, and I thought I ought not, I think. And then I recognized you, prey. And I think, I'm a predator. I know. I feel I must. I say, let me bite your life until you are no longer living. Elegy. And we, the workers, we search the place of the earth as a burial place, trying to find what's missing in the being of humanity. And we'll say, keep going till you reach the hole, till we reach the hole, keep going till we reach the hole, the one with all the answers, the grave with evidence. I would like to say, here is where I come to be free. But I say to you instead, this is where I come to get clean. And you say, no, this is where you come to work. And I say, yes, that's what I said. And you say, no, this is where you come. This is where you come. This is where you come. And I say, no, this is where we live. This is what we cannot leave. This is where we cannot depart. Elegy. They call it a relationship. We call it an atrocity. We mean anguish. They call it a beginning, and they mean your world here is finished. Would you leave? And we show them there is an opening in the earth. You call it hell. We mean remembering. We have drawn you into it. We say draw. We mean crawl. We show you how to do it. You must get down. Small. They say it is too small. We say no, it is smaller. There's a smallness here that opens, and we say, your world is over. And they say, can we leave now? And they mean, don't leave us alone in this place. Elegy. Let me begin again. There are bystanders today, like always. They arrive as the clouds cover the sun. There are the watchers today, like always, who so shut their eyes, like always. The listeners arrive, carrying armfuls of silence. The listeners mute the birds. There are the speakers here, as always, with their lips sewn tight, with strings hanging from behind their teeth, mouths stitched shut, throats throttled, words hidden, deep as hollows in the mountainside at dawn with the rising of the winter solstice sun. There are the dwellers today, like always, the workers, the first responders, the ones who cannot leave. The witnesses, the warriors, the survivors, who refuse to leave. The dwellers, the warriors, the survivors, the witnesses, as always, who do not arrive because there was never a leave-taking, because this earth is a site of constant atrocity, who will not leave us be and will not take us away until it has had its fill of us. And we have no lids on our eyes, no lips to our mouths, no hands for our ears. And the warriors, the dwellers, the ones who are still here have arrived, never having left. We walk through the snow in bare feet, the patterns of foot soles melt in the soil to reveal the ancient scarlet beating underneath. There is a look, do you see? A hole. It's a hole in a sky that we call closure. It is an event horizon that swings open. It is a lost hole come home. Go through. Go through. Though our hands are shaking, our skin struggles, go through. We will say to you, this was your world, and it is over. It will be a lie. It is never over. And this is the sound of your skin, slipping, slipping off. Instead, pull our eyes open, pull our ears open, pull our eyelids wide, make the eyelids wet like a mouth that cannot stop speaking.
Thank you. So many things to talk about in this wonderful piece. And one of the things I wanted to talk to you about is your use of repetition. And it's marvelous, really evocative and powerful, especially the moment, the phrase, this is, this is, this is. And another moment was, I do it, I do it. And then you would also repeat the list, the warriors, the dwellers, the witnesses. Would you talk about this, your approach to repetition? How do you keep it from becoming a texture that you don't see anymore?
It's quite likely that I overuse it.
No, not at all. No. I think, no, it's musical.
I mean, it's something that I reserve for particular, like the book, it's an elegy that begins the book, and the subsequent sections are very poetic, many are more traditional narrative, and I don't find as much use for repetition in things that are fairly self-explanatory. I think it comes, the repetition, there are two places that it probably comes from. One is, I sustained a brain injury during field work when I was about 20. And so often people have to tell me the same thing over and over again. And I need repetition in order to grasp what someone is saying. And people who know me well often know they have to say the same thing to me several times before I can fully process it when my brain injury is acting up. And I think that very much goes along with trauma, which is something that this book is about, and a lot, is a refrain throughout my work in general. The other thing I think is actually a vestige of the amount of human rights work that I did, where I worked directly extracting precise information from people. People's tendency when trying to express themselves clearly is to get as simple as possible. Like, this is what happened. This is what this man did to me. This occurred in this prison. This is where the helicopter dropped the bodies. Well, in a foreign language or working across languages, the use of synonyms is actually really interesting, because if you introduce enough when you're speaking, it gives the person who's trying to tell the story a lot more choices than their vocabulary might normally provide. I don't know if this makes sense. It's kind of a trick. Mm-hmm. But a lot of times, particularly if there's a language difference, saying the same, the use of synonyms to say the same thing over and over and over again is also a layering of meaning. Mm. Would you like to take this train, this streetcar, this carriage? Someone's likely to understand one of those words in translation. And I think there's something about we got, and this book is very much about those of us who guard ourselves against shattering, and those of us who shatter over and over and over again. And so the repetition, I think, is that hammer striking at the vessel until it breaks. Like, I can't say it enough sometimes because I need it to crack. I need to crack the surface tension and let something intense come out. To me, it's an organic thing. It's not the content demands it. My emotions demand it. It's not a trick pony that I haul out for signature moments or something.
Right. It's no mere rhetorical device.
Thank you. That's a more sophisticated way of saying that. Yeah.
There's another moment that I really loved in that the elegies that you read. There was kind of a riff on thinking as a kind of knowing, and it reminded me of something Susan Sontag said, which was, I have the impression that thinking is a form of feeling, and that feeling is a form of thinking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That was also a shout out to Sontag.
Oh, so you were playing off of her. Yeah.
Yes.
And you were using repetition there too to kind of hammer, using that hammer to break something open.
Yeah. I mean, who pays attention to a woodpecker who pecks on the tree once? It just becomes part of the sonic texture. What makes something a woodpecker is that it will not stop. And you're like, how many times do you have to actually drill your beak into that tree? As many times as it takes to get the worm out. That's kind of my jackhammer personality of humanitarianism or humanism or something. Like, how many times? How many times will it take?
Wow, this was an amazing conversation. Thank you so much.
Oh my God, thank you. I could talk to you for hours.
Likewise, likewise.
I'm so grateful for everything that you are doing for our community. The difference before you were on the scene and when you have worked all your webs between all of us, it's brought such a tremendous sense of community and intimacy and treating each other well in the independent world of independent publishing, independent writing. I just really appreciate the vision that you have for our field. But yeah, it's noticeable, maybe different qualities that have been gone for too long.
Oh, wow, thank you so much. That does it for our show. Thanks for listening to Jamming Their Transmission. I'm John Madera. Until next time, and always, be the strange you wish to see in the world.